Amazing!
Yeah? Yeah. Super nice. Okay, well, this is Eva. She's from Estonia. And my name is François. I'm from the world. I'm from France. We are both part of Makvaerket and food sharing. Now, we will have some. Actually, originally the idea would be to show you how to get more information about the project once we are not there to present it anymore. So, you can use YouTube, for instance, and just write Makvaerket. So, how do you spell it? M-A-K-V... maybe we can see. We have a website and a Facebook. Right? Makvaerket, so M-A-K... and then there is this funny Danish letter which is A with double dots and then R, K, E, T. It's actually Swedish. Sorry for my French. So it's Swedish, but if you write it in Danish then it's A and E together, kissing, hugging. Quite cute. Okay, we brought some propaganda because we don't have so much time, and Makvaerket is a big project. It's somehow like a fusion between the Institute for X and here, where we are, and the floating city. But it has a different base somehow, because here, who wants the ground? You! Well, through the commune. The Institute for X. And floating city, you want the ground?
Real estate,
real estate company.
Yeah, I think it's okay. Private.
And Makvaerket, who wants the grant?
Yeah.
It's actually a foundation. Foundation for ecological construction and practices in the world. It's called LEUB. And I brought some propaganda from them. They are into Earthship, mass oven, to stay warm in the winter. So this you can take. If you don't know Danish, Google Translate or poke a friend, local Viking aborigines around you. And then we have a few flyers. We are producing our own apple juice also at Makvaerket, and we brought it. No panic, it's super organic, so you can pass it around. We only have one, so sharing is caring. You can, or people can pick it up, I don't know, afterwards. They will be available for you guys. We have this multi-hole flyer, quite nice. You can also... we will keep it.
Yeah.
But this you can take, and this is about the apple juice project, how it's made, and so on. But this you can take, we have a few, yes. We have this little booklet we like also to keep, but you can read it, you can take pictures, and you can also write or give us your email, and we can send you digital copies of this. But this we like to keep physical, because when we have volunteers from all over the world, or people just coming by to visit the project, and it's good to have these to handle. So this one is an information zine, printed on recycled paper in Sweden. And so it was made, we had some meetings, like the core organization group, the plenum, so-called, at Makvaerket. And then we put this together, it's like the systems, how we organize, the history of the place, the values, and so on. Because, again, the presentation right here, right now, is a bit short, and it's a lot of information. The whole day we are going to receive, so that's maybe something we want to have a copy of. We have digital again, but we can pass it around if we want. We use a consensus way of making decisions. If you don't know about it, speak up there or Google. We have meetings actually every 2 months, the plenum. And then, because first we had meetings every month, beginning of the month, but then we thought let's have some fun together, so we do a one-time meeting and then one-time working weekend, and you're all invited to the next working weekend, which is in December, the first weekend of December. I will teach facilitate a workshop on how to write a newsletter, both in English and in a local Aborigine Viking language, and there will be other workshops.
Maybe
Christmas. Christmas presents out of recycled materials. Chikaban, same as Crossing City. And then on Sunday, we have a knitting workshop because it's getting a bit cold outside, global warming. So then you can be cozy and make your Christmas presents for your family or for yourself. And this is quite also an interesting book. It's written by somebody who was traveling around in Germany and above, in Scandinavia, and visited some self-governed collectives, art organization. And he wrote a little nice summary with drawings and so on. We only have one copy, so again, if you want a digital copy, you write your name, a piece of paper, we will put somewhere, and then we can give you the digital copy, but here it is for you to see if you want. Meanwhile, pictures describe better than thousands of words. Okay, we have people's picture. This is the Makvaerket, is an old brick ceramic factory which went bankrupt in the 80s. It's 200 years old. There were 300 employees working there at some point. So it's 10,000 square meter. Here you can see part of the garden that we have established. We try to be self-sustainable in electricity, food, and yes, it's a collective, as like working collective and environmental collective. So nobody lives there. But we have now satellites around the place. Makvaerket is located 70 kilometers out of Copenhagen. So now we have a collective, living collective, because babies came out of the project actually. again, apple juice, if you like. This is one of the rooms that we restore totally. We have agreement with bakeries, so we make people's kitchen where it's open to everyone. Both the local bakery and bakery in Copenhagen. We make people's kitchen where we invite everyone to join. And we have like a local band playing jazz maybe in the multi hall. Sorry, there while we eat and so on. So this is how it looks now. We have pictures from how it looked before. So we make apple juice with different types of apples. So some of the roofs in the factory collapse, and then we clean it all and then create a new space. Everything is perfect space. No
and
one
also the material that we get from the collapsed spaces, then we recycle it. For example, the bricks that we use for new structures, then these are the bricks that collapsed inside.
So before,
wow.
After.
Wow.
And after. So it's electricity free kitchen. We reuse the bricks, as Eva mentioned, to make an oven, like a pizza oven, so electricity free. We invite other collectives to join. We have had the luck to be selected by the Nevers from Axe and Keller group in Germany. And so we hosted in this summer, like last summer, this summer, 38 something carpenters, bricklayers, blacksmith, and tailor. Maybe we have pictures. Yes. And they came. Half of them, gentlemen. The other half ladies, and super skilled, old-fashioned carpentry, all the handwork, as you can see. And they actually helped us to create this corridor of light in between the factory, and saving this way the factory from drowning. Because again, it's 200 years old, the brick old ceramic factory, and it needs a lot of maintenance. So this is one way to do it. So you see, it was super funny and cozy. We made food for them and gave them beers, and they went. And a very efficient German plan to produce this beautiful 100 meters long glass roof. This is Eva producing the juice that I can drink there with some volunteers from Brazil and Argentina. So So yeah, it's mechanical press. We make workshops as well for kids and grown-up kids like us. out of maybe papier-mâché, we make masks and so on. This is like a seminar room, but I mean it's 10,000 square meters again, so it's quite big. Come and visit.
Yeah.
This is where we now have established a kitchen, multi-functional kitchen, storage, a cafe, and a bathroom. And this is how it used to look before we insulated it. We have amazing New Year's Eve parties. Maybe we're not going to have one this year, but yes. We may, actually, it's a floating city fireworks. Homemade fireworks.
Yeah, with the steel wool, I think.
Yeah, with steel particles for last New Year's Eve. So we are deconstructing and rebuilding this old factory into a culture production center where we hold a workshop, invite, this is for instance Noah, friend of the earth, coming. We are renting the space that we have renovated. We have three different prices for if you like the grassroots, like Noah or friend of the earth. Then you get like a really cheap, or not really cheap price, but friendly price or something, where people just pay for the consumption of the water and electricity that they use. We have compost toilets, if you want to use the water, 6 liter water flushing toilet, which is not so environmental friendly, you can, but then we need to have the storage tank, which needs to be empty, so then rather use the compost toilet, that's the idea. We have a hot solar system, hot solar shower system or hot solar system, mass oven, this is a rocket stove because we have 20 meters high chimneys that we connect, and then this is then we can have like a bench, a warm bench to heat up the building.
So the chimney still work?
We use the draft actually.
Yeah.
If you have 20 meters high chimney, then you can have 10 meters long bench.
Yeah.
You get this natural draft. It's quite cool. This is the kitchen, how it looks. Now it's like it's totally full of great equipment to cook. This is how we restored it actually. Alright, and I wanted to show you the video, but I'm not sure if we can do that. So you go on, YouTube. And M-A-K-E-S.
And of course, like all of your building, it's all made of recycled materials and natural materials. So, like all this construction that you saw there, it's just like purely nature, environmental friendly methods and materials.
Because again, it's this foundation who owns the place. They got it from Copenhagen Commune. One corner, one symbolic corner for the whole place, plus one corner for like the there is some land around and the artificial lake. Because to make clay and ceramic, you need to extract the clay. So there is actually a big lake. Maybe collaboration with Floating City at some point, and we can make some platform there. The place is polluted, the same as here in Gospen. So that's often the challenges that we face sometimes. Because you want to make like, why the kids come and play, but then if they put their fingers in the ground, which kids like to do, and then put their in their mouth because that's what they like to do as well, it can go a bit sour. But we try to restore the so-called damaged environment by first inviting people and putting them together to do it, and by doing it, so we have permaculture techniques, and we have established a food forest, planted bushes, trees, and we have different groups, same as Floating City, garden group, and factory group, which is like more internal volunteers. We can play the video without the sound, maybe. Yeah. Background thing. Yes. All right. And yes. volunteers, they meet once a week. Ah, by the way, if you have any questions, just raise your hand and speak out. Okay, this is, yes?
I remember when I was there, someone was talking how you're paying rent for the spaces that you renovated.
Yeah.
But not for the entire thing?
Oh, yeah, that's right. The farm owns the factory. And so they have to pay the local tax. So we just have to make sure that we pay the rent to them of the place that we renovated. And it's a friendly price, very friendly. We have a very good relationship with them. So we pay for electricity, the water, and the rent, and they pay for the local tax, and that's how it works. So it's not a squat as such at all. Yes, you can see before after on the pictures you see, and again you can just go on YouTube as you saw, right, Makvaerket. We have Facebook. This is when we make a festival. This is a way to actually move forward with the renovation of the place in quite fast pace. When you invite a lot of people for 1 month, because now it's a bit cold, the factory. So I will suggest if you want to come and visit, you are more than welcome actually. Now in December, I will be there, I can give you a tour. I live 7 kilometers away from the place, in a small wooden house together with Eva and some other friends. As I said, like the satellites around Makvaerket, the collectives, living collectives, and but it's, I think, a lot better to come in spring, so the reuse of materials, to make a compost toilet. The foundation is providing a lot of materials, because they actually do a showcase somehow by, restoring the historical buildings that we have in Denmark, using and showing that you can use natural construction materials. You don't need to use plastic or paint or plastic isolation or all these later problems construction materials. So we use this and we make workshops. So we have a WordPress, a Facebook group. The meetings that we have at the factory, for instance, we respect very much people's choices in terms of gender and other diet wishes. So we have made a structure for the meetings where you present yourself with your name and then the pronoun you want to be called with. So my name is François, I would like to be called with she. So people that know, okay. The diet, like I'm vegan or something, so then people know. And we have culture nights where people can actually, also like the volunteers, coming from all over the world to a roofing and Helpex program. We don't have a work away, like a floating city, but we have Helpex and roofing. Then they can also present the country where they come from, the culture. We have sauna. Is it finished?
Maybe food, time for food sharing?
Okay. Yes.
Basically, like about Makvaerket, it's the information that you hear right now and see some pictures, but actually, it's much more clear when you actually go there and you see what's going on. Because you really agree there.
So yeah, it's massive space. Walk in and you're just like, wow, this is amazing.
It's impossible to get this feeling on the beaches or beers. And as we were talking about food, as like food is connecting people, and in Makvaerket we also use the concept of food shares basically, because François had originally he had the agreement in Aarhus already back in the days, and then in Copenhagen also now there was a market in Vandby, which is the main market where in the mornings the shops go send their vans to get the food, vegetables, fruits, whatever, and then we had the agreement of getting the leftovers that they would otherwise throw So it's basically this market that we go to now. It's a little bit out of Copenhagen, but it's at least 2 tons every morning. And then the donations, because we don't dumpster dive. It's just directly approaching the people and telling them just from personal level that okay, you see this here, and I think that I would eat this, and you think that you would also eat this, but now you have to throw it out. So instead, we can take this and we can redistribute this to people in need, also volunteers, as well as Makvaerket, because it's voluntary based. So we use this tool to then share the knowledge of food waste, basically. So the food sharing and Makvaerket, there are some ways they are, they share the values of food. And in food sharing, it started in Copenhagen in May, together with Flotixi, because there were the initiators who came from Germany, because it already started in Germany, I don't know exactly how long time ago.
2012.
2012, yes. And then they came in Copenhagen to find collaborators who would like to start this here, locally. And then we and Float City and local activists got inspired. And Francois already had the action to share the food. Then he was helping. Since then, we have every week, we have a sharing point. At least one. It started in Floating City, of course, with the help of local volunteers, and gathering all the food in the morning, and then setting up the point where people can come and pick up the food. Like, no restrictions and no like, completely equal sharing.
Whoops.
We have different platforms to organize.
Yes, now that we, in the beginning it was quite small, so it was simple somehow to communicate with people, but now it's growing, it's expanding. There is many volunteers who join the project every week when we have the point set up, and then we have volunteers who talk and say, okay, this is the food, but our idea is not to just bring the food to people. It's more that we bring the food to explain and show that this is the food that's not supposed to be here, because this is considered as fresh and it's leftovers. So we have a problem in the system of having this totally fine food being thrown out. So maybe we should consider what are we actually buying, or what is the food, or what is the fresh. So just to bring the awareness to people that there is food waste. And there is locations in the world where there is no food. So So in this way, the people get inspired, and then they want to join and like say, okay, we want to definitely help you. So what can we do? And we offer them to come join us as volunteers as being on the spot, and then next we explain and get first. The knowledge that we pass on to them, and then they come next week, and then they share this to the new people and say, okay, what's going on? And this way we educate each other and we share the willingness, and also people can come to join as IT specialists, for example, because it doesn't make the people to come there every week and like contribute with their time every morning when they actually have to be at work maybe. So there's different ways you can contribute. So now we have platforms that we are trying to reach more people, not in the sense of coming to the events, but more getting the awareness of food waste, because this is the eventual goal for us, to get the understanding. Because most of the waste that's being created in is actually in our homes. So we need to reconsider what we are buying and if we need this full package of avocados, for example, or if we throw out 3 of them out of 5. And then the platforms are like WordPress in the beginning. Now we are migrating into Weebly. We have Slack, if you have heard of this platform. It's kind of like a the whole history and be informed, because in the beginning it was in Facebook groups, not working, no. So now we have a page that will communicate information, and then interior information. Internal information is on Slack and small meetings. We also have working groups now, so we are all creating this system. So it would be really great to get more inspiration and ideas from people who already have the experience. Because yes, we are running into different challenges. For example, the Slack. So already opened somewhere? And then, for example, if we have people who want to contribute their time, and then we have a schedule of one spot where we have a sharing spot, and then it's different tasks that somebody needs to go to the bakery the evening before to get from the renovation. We have another green up there. Get all these huge bags of bakery, organic, nice and then they have to bring it in the morning to the sharing point. Then before that, there is some people who need to go to the market, which is 20 kilometers from the center around. So it needs to be a car, because somebody has to drive a car, a van, because it's going to be 2 tons of wood in your car. So small car, not really. And then there is volunteers who need to put it out. Then there is people who need to explain that this is the food, but like don't rush. Like actually, it's you just see that there is some food, but in reality there is a lot of food waste. So there is people volunteering who need to stand there and explain what's going on. And then in the evening there is somebody who needs to feed. So it's all these different tasks, and a challenge with this is to organize how people are writing themselves there. So far it's been practically in Excel spreadsheet. So it's on the page, it's embedded as you see on the picture, but then people can edit the cells. And it's a bit confusing because, for example, on mobile phone, then it looks different and then you can't even access it. So it struggles like this. So this is like the first thing, if you have some pop-up, some ideas of IT side, like how to have a platform, a sheet that everybody can edit without being really registered user, but just have the possibility.
And around that, maybe I'm asking a couple of questions.
Yeah, and then let's put words into action. Yeah? Okay. How about food sharing rules? Then maybe we would like to invite to consider. You can be initiator in this. It's not like rocket science. So it's possible, I guess, to start here as well. So it all depends on what you do. If you do nothing, nothing is going to happen. You can organize, and we would like to help you to set up eventually. I have some agreements here as well, because I used to live here before. That's a start, and then I think maybe there is an application. There will be a presentation about an application in a second, but eventually, maybe you can use this application in the presentation. Application. So then, and this place would be a nice place to meet, or as a fair food sharing pickup point, fair pickup point, maybe.
Sounds like you have everything figured out, you just need a person that will actually do it.
That's right, yeah. So, don't be shy.
Do you know
the time is now.
Do you know if there's something in Oz already that is similar to food sharing?
I was one of the people starting the kind of one and only People's Kitchen for free in Treuburg-Bebrusit, 8 years ago now. Oh. And it's every Sunday, by the way, so tomorrow, if you're hungry, come and join. Yeah, we're going to pick up the veggies from the market that donate the veggies with a smile. Yeah, and the bakery as well. Right, eventually. So, but I don't think, I don't know. Like, I was so happy to see Skull Cafe popping up one day. Brilliant.
Yeah, well, that's it.
Then there's been like a, but now it seems like yeah, there's a momentum for both food waste for the establishments, like EU. Oh, yes, we have a bit of waste. Like, in Denmark, it's 700,000 tons, right? A year thrown out. So, and then the question I would say is, okay, I think it's great to do such a charity or yeah, social work with the so-called waste of our market monetary system, but I will like still to ask the question and to be creative and so on with the so-called waste, and maybe make a supermarket so that can sell food, earn money, and ship of Denmark to the poor people out in Africa and so on. But I think we should just still, first of all, maybe take care of the homeless here before we pretend to be able to solve problems. It sounds like a colonialism, no? When you come to a country and say, hey, you know what? We know what to do. So, yeah. But you call it a social business, and you can have CBR, corporate responsibility, and green brain wash people. But anyways, so I think the question to ask is, why do we have 700,000 tons of food thrown out a year here in Denmark or in other places in the world? Why do you have people starving to death? And because I think it's, I think it's good to be creative with the so-called waste, but I think it's, the idea is to really to bring awareness.
There's a question.
Oh, well, I have a question specifically. So I live in Aarhus, and I've been to the People's Kitchen, and the People's Kitchen, I think, has trouble getting people to go pick up the vegetables. So how do you motivate your volunteers with food sharing or food sharing in Copenhagen to be a part of this and do this every week? And is it just having so much enthusiasm?
We invite people to contribute, and they contribute if they want to, if they have time, and yeah, it resonates in them. And I guess Copenhagen has more people than those in, like, in terms of potential to help. So it's a bit easier in my experience to get people active, but nevertheless, Aarhus is quite active with entrepreneurship and so on, so it's possible. And how we do it, in Aarhus, because I've been doing this by myself for 2 years before actually some people started to be like, oh, hey, wait, now you're going to Copenhagen. Maybe we should be introduced to the farmers because, you're going to leave, and then, it might die. So, and then one guy decided to come the last day before I left Copenhagen, and then I could introduce him to, and he was the, and he's still the manager of the local house in Trøjborg. The commune also, like in Sweden, they are closing this beboelset, which is like the neighbor house, to centralize culture in here, or there, in the official Gosben culture. So that's actually the same dynamic as you've been experiencing in Sweden since the, now, like within the last 10 years. So cutting down local houses, promoting culture, social activities, and so on, and then centralizing it here. They even have a Folkekuchner restaurant out there. I met the guy who actually started it. I had a talk with him, and I told him about this People's Kitchen, Folkekuchner in Trøjborg, and how he did it, and so on. And then he got inspired and just took the name. And now you can buy a plate for 100 kroner out there. Anyways.
Go about and then we'll go into the exchange library.
Yeah, I was interested in the part you were saying about how there was some part of the people who were making this discourse of explaining that there is food everywhere. I think that I've been really inspired by Barcelona squatters, like Vikings Food Yet. It's really amazing what they did. These people, they like basically took the best of the 90s squatters and probably learned like big lessons from like all the movements that have like anti-globalization and the housing movement, and it's really crazy. They really managed to bring all that into the social center format.
Mm-hmm.
So bringing really strict, deep-rooted, and critical principles,
mm-hmm.
but at the same time removing all kinds of ideological, identitarian issues for people to be able to come and so to have a radical yet inclusive space.
Mm-hmm.
And what they did, the way they work is to so it worked really well. I mean, they started a group for skipping and also starting to make agreements with the local stores and the cooperatives and so on. They even have agreements to go and work on the land of the cooperatives they take food from, and there's
mm-hmm.
a lot of work.
Mm-hmm.
So it was so successful because of their way of organizing
mm-hmm.
that the first group reached like 25, 30 people. It's continued expanding. They started a new group. They had two groups, and then it started. Everyone started seeing that it worked really well. So it expanded to other neighborhoods, and the concept is really being taken over by other people. But it doesn't always work. And so I see that they have really strict way of understanding how people can be included in their network. So for instance. They don't let people come in and just join the assembly. You have to come as there's a week in which, like the week it happens,
mm-hmm.
and as closed meeting, and sometimes it's open meeting. And when it's open meeting, there's someone half an hour before who's there to explain how the specifics of
mm-hmm.
how it works and so on. And bridging to what Francois was also saying, they have really developed this these reflections on this assistentialism of social work, or they are saying, well, it's not about helping in a paternalistic way, it's about mutual support, so people get together, get organized. And I don't know if that resonates a bit with the discourse that you say people are sharing when there is the people coming.
Yes, we are trying to find the ways. At the moment we are, because it's all like under process, we're testing. So at the moment we are trying to organize inside the groups, that we have different groups, and then inside the group it's actually the self-educating or educating each other. So for example, if there is a group who makes the agreements with new bakeries, new organizations, and then there's somebody, for example, Francois, who already has done it before, so he goes and presents this precisely to these people in the group who are interested in how to do it. And then there's another group who needs the input of having more like data, for example, about food waste, and to understand more what is the topic of this, and solutions, and why, what are we actually doing in that context. So it's this group way of organizing at the moment that we're trying out.
Okay, so are we going to stop there? We're going to be completely out of time.
The volunteers, how we motivate them in Copenhagen is with this. If you volunteer as food sharing, you get like you take 1 hour. So this is our currency.
Thank you very much for the presentations for the mornings from the Exchange Library. Who's standing for that?
I'm over here. And
there are any slides? Yeah, there are.
I have slides. Do you have slides? Yeah. I can't just start having
initiative now in Copenhagen also, you can read more, we wrote flyers, it's from bloggers' place. How to start with people's city. Urban mysticism creates a city. It's in English. Check it out.
First of all, do you know if there are any studies on like information like
I think the EU now wants to speed up and stop food waste. Okay, we're going to start with the presentation. Well, since we've got 20 minutes till the break, time to sort of we're going to have to have a whole discussion after lunch, probably. If you could try and keep it to about 10 minutes. And then
the thing is, the name is part of my slot, so I'll take 10 to 12 minutes and then do the rest.
Okay, well let me make an announcement about it. I've timed it so badly that the shared discussion is going to have to happen after lunch in the place where the debate was. So we've got 2 hours there. If people have saved up questions and discussion points, they can raise them there, talk about them there. And then some more focused debate if we manage that. So we'll do that after lunch. Now we've got about 20 minutes, so we can use... Yeah, well, that'll be about fair. I mean, if you on the presentation and then questions to you, we'll just do that in some moment.
Okay. That's very good idea.
Yeah. Okay. So the project I'm here to talk about today is called Exchange Library. It's a part of a larger artistic research-based project called Trade Test Site that was started in 2015. By the artist Lise, who I'm partnering up with for this Exchange Library project. And this big, huge project is operating in three different ways. There's the Exchange Library, which is a physical swap shop. It's got a printing part of it, where it's an international collaborative project with artists and scholars and all types of people getting together and publishing their own musings on envisioning new, alternative, better economic systems that are more sustainable. And then there's a public program, which are workshops, symposiums, conferences, and all kinds of things where we invite the public in. The Exchange Library is a barter store. We are based in Room 6 of now, which is an artist-driven project and exhibition space because it started as an artistic project since Lise is an artist, and it also is fueled by her frustration in this economic system of artists not being paid what they're actually worth, what their work is actually worth. And then she tried to lay down a plan for how could we make a new economic system revolving around these trade and labor and maybe avoiding money as much as we can. And what you see here is our original shop display. We've changed it now. One of the things that we do, we have this physical platform where we put food production machines at people's disposal. So we have apple press, a flour mill, a butter churner, meat grinders, all kinds of stuff, trying to empower people to produce more themselves. And we also teach them, do open workshops for free. And teach people how to use these machines, how to ferment, how to produce more at home, and how easily it can be done, and how much healthier and cheaper it actually is to do it. We focus a lot on fermentation. We are really crazy about all the healthy probiotic benefits of bacteria, and they're amazing cooks, I would like to say. They do everything. I mean, they're in our wines, our sausages, our cheeses, fermented foods, of course, in extremely well tasting drinks like kombucha and kefir. So they're all over the place. And one other thing is about taking back the power
the project is overall about taking back the power from this oppressive capitalistic system, and one of the ways to do that is to produce more yourself. If you buy fermented foods from the supermarket, you don't get the same nutritional value out of them because they have been pasteurized, so all the good bacteria is dead. So it's basically dead food. So that's why we focus a lot on fermentation. On the left is the one of the shelves we have with some fermented foods that we do ourselves. There's a ginger beer, amongst other things, of course, sauerkraut and fermented chilies and all kinds of good stuff. So people can come into the store and barter something for a fermented foods. And on the right, there is an exhibition display that Lisa presented recently at the exhibition in Bergen. And the booklets are displayed here on the book on the table. And you can have a look, and if there's still any left, I think you can take some of them with you. And they explain really nicely the theoretical musings, starting from Gibbs and Graham, if you know the two feminist economists, talking about alternative economies and other projects that are like ours and that we are inspired from by it. This is a picture of our new display. I just wanted to show how we displayed the food production machines, and we are called Exchange Library in a Danish context, and that confuses people a lot. It's too abstract. So it just prevented people from coming in because they didn't quite understand what it is with the Exchange Library and the machines. And so now we displayed the fermented foods in the window, hoping that people will get it, that they can get that in the shop. It's a test that we're running. We found that we wrote the free workshops on the display on the window, and people, that's our best form of marketing ever. We just hit a gold mine with that one, because so many people walk by and they're really intrigued. And the first one is also called Cooking with Bacteria, which is contraintuitive, but people just loved it anyways, and we had a huge turnout. So we're trying different systems.